and the Navy's nuclear research submarine. They have, I'm not sure how many, about 4 reactors going on there above Idaho Falls, upriver, kind of underground river. And Hanford, I just came from there because it was Fukushima Day, and there was a ceremony there by the river in Richland, Washington, which is the most exposed and dangerously poised population of the country, like Chernobyl, the village. That's Richland, Washington, so all your hearts go to protect that. And there was a ceremony protection and safety, and everywhere is everybody every year on Fukushima Day. Do this wherever you are, and go to any nuclear sites and expose them to the surrounding populace and get it into the news so everybody knows to shut them down. And so every nuclear site, which would be the closest to Eugene that you might worry about, is at Corvallis. OSU has a quarter-sized nuclear reactor operating, doing experiments for the Navy and for China. They train the Chinese operators for the 10 nuclear reactors that are there, and so a lot of money goes into our cool agricultural wave power college into the Department of Engineering for nuclear power that could blow us all away because of 10 reactors in China, which will just blow to America. And so anyways, nukeinfo.net is our website, and hopefully this map is there. Otherwise, Facebook, a nice friend helped me out on this, and I'm not very good on it, and it just began, but it's Nuclear Northwest. So go find that somewheres on Facebook, and you can stay connected on the this alliance of the Columbia River Basin Stewardship Alliance that's growing. Of the 9 tribes, well, there's 11 tribes that surround Hanford, and then there's Pendleton, and it's mainly Spokane that's most endangered, the biggest population, 250,000 people. And the winds blow straight towards Spokane most of the time. All the time I was there, they blew strongly north and east, right towards Spokane, and there's nothing in between. So they're the biggest population that's the most endangered. But the closest is Richland, and the rest of the Tri-Cities are Kennewick and Pasco, and then Yakima. And most of that area is now of Hispanic, so other tribes of the South have come up. And so it's a whole bunch of native people live in this area. And it's the cattlemen, the eastern, the cowboys, the Grange, you know. It's all going to get spewed with this nuclear fallout from if it does a Fukushima. Absolutely. And I'm so thankful to you for coming to Eugene.
I love your map. Your map is awesome.
All right.
I love it.
This is for you.
Thank you so much. I want to say this one thing. I went to the protest on Songs down there. We really were well organized down there. And those meetings were intense. They bust in fake union workers all over. The NRC followed me around. I've been fighting with the NRC. They followed me around. They had a cop come up to me, and I didn't do anything. I was vlogging, videotaping. And as soon as the Q&A, the cop comes up, and I secretly filmed it. And they kicked me out. But we went over to Songs to protest, you know, right next to Pendleton. Get this. And I told the woman I was with, I said, look at the top of the light poles. And I posted these pictures all over. In the employee parking lot at San Ofrio, which, by the way, had an accident in January. A lot of people don't know that. It had an accident, and the reactor melted down, and it took grassroots activists to block it. Well, they took the generator, parked it out in the Utah desert behind my house. I'm out there with a Geiger counter slide, and they tried to arrest me out there. They had to build a special truck for it. But on top of the light poles at San Ofrio are out there. She says, what are those? They're solar. Solar panels in the employee parking lot at Song's Nuclear Generator in San Diego. I thought it was the greatest metaphor ever. But that's the war they've waged on us. We went down there, they busted in fake union workers. It was intense in there. It was packed. We were well organized. It was a great meeting. It's all online. And if you ever want to get really up to date what's going on, Helen Cavalcott's symposium on the 12th and on the 11th and the 12th coincided. It just got done. I'll post a link all over my website. You watch that thing. That is, there is more knowledge crammed in that 2-day seminar with every expert than you will gain in, you know, 6 years of college easily. It is brilliant. It is magnificent. Your map, I'm going to get this map out all over. I love it, and I really appreciate your work.
Have them go to the mic, Lonnie?
Huh?
Have him just go to that mic, because this is really difficult.
We can get you off.
I think I know how to solve the problem. I've been working on it since 1992. I think I know how to overhaul the United States Constitution, and I think I know what it should look like. And I was wondering if you could commit to say 30 minutes to start to read what I have, if I sent it to feed meal to you.
Oh, I'd love to. Okay. I absolutely love to. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm all about grassrooters. This organization has to be so grassroots. And I think this is the most grassroots thing in the world. I mean, look at us right here. Lonnie, you know, I come up here. That's what's so beautiful about this whole thing. There's nobody sponsoring nobody. This is a bunch of individual grassroots people that are doing this tirelessly, penniously, because they care, because they love other people. They love other people. They love Mother Earth. We love each other. We're doing this out of love. I'm doing this out of love. I love people. I honestly love people. I love people, and I love life. And that's the people that I've seen that are involved in this. They're truth tellers, and we have one thing on our side as grassrooters. We don't need money. We have love on our side, one. But two, we have the truth on our side. And that's all we need. And I really am a believer in humanity, and I believe humanity is going to get this right. And I really do believe that we will overcome. I really do believe that.
I'd like to turn you on to two really awesome books that I am studying. And Dr. Helen Caldicott was so inspiring up at the Hanford rally that was in last April up at Richland, at this other park, just a short way away from where we just had the ceremony at Howard Amon Park.
It's listed on YouTube too.
Okay.
So you can look for
it. Oh, yeah. And she, yeah. And. It was divided up into each of the speakers on YouTube, and Helen Caldicott was one of them, and she was very powerful, and American Indian Movement speakers were there, and all this other. So this book was given to me from Lloyd Marbet, who hopes that everybody who is involved in this movement will study up. And this one is called Life's Delicate Balance, Causes and Prevention of Breast Cancer by Jeanette D. Sherman, Dr. Jeanette D. Sherman. This one describes how radiation damages cells and changes the genetic makeup of the world and all that stuff. And yet it focuses on breast cancer, but it has all the good stuff. And then there's this symbiosis of radiation with pesticides and radiation with pharmaceuticals in the water and all the dioxin and DES and all the other doo-wah ditties. So the other one is from one of our greatest guides. Dr. John Goffman was director. You did great.
I did know him.
So he defected from working hard for the government for a while at Lawrence Livermore Labs down by San Francisco in the Bay Area, trying to decipher how radiation harms and this and that. And that he realized as the government was trying to have him disprove other people's accounts that radiation was very harmful to human beings and we shouldn't mess around with it, he quit, was shut down in his funding. So he became the one to expose the ways of it. And this book is called Irrevy, or I-R-R-E-V-Y is the only little word. And he says it's an irreverent illustrated view of nuclear power by John Goffman. And it teaches you so much in these short things. And it's got
also wrote Poison Power.
Poison Hour?
Poison Power.
Oh, Poison Power, yeah.
Damn.
And so he exposes these things. And so there's much to be learned from these people. And Helen Caldicott organizes it in her website. So
she's amazing.
Go to her things, which is the new.
It's HelenCaldicott.org.
Yeah. New York All School right. of Medicine's where she works through.
Say it again.
Helen Caldicott's website is HelenCaldicott.org. Actually, it's not even org. She's podcasted this symposium that she sponsored on March 11th and March 12th. She brought together 24 scientists who brought together brand new information that it has been heretofore been suppressed. And it is still suppressed, because did we hear any of it on the mainstream media? Absolutely not. So, look, this is the point of all of this, is for all of us each, that whoever we are, we all have to take action and study these things ourselves and decide that we're going to get active and learn about nuclear. It's really nuclear contamination, because we have all been contaminated. It is not if we're going to be contaminated. We have been contaminated, and it is ongoing. And the worst part for me is that it's genetic mutations. My grandchildren might have genetically mutated children. There's a high probability of that. So until we all come together and figure out how we're going to, as you know, she spoke earlier, we need to be able to speak together to figure out how we're going to come together and get other people excited enough and aware enough that it becomes personal to them, that they're going to start getting involved with organizations, calling our elected officials and tell them to stop drinking the Kool-Aid, literally, the nuclear Kool-Aid that's all of our congressmen are drinking right now. And, you know, there really isn't really any one big answer. Carl Grossman basically said we all have to each find our own path, and I am a firm believer in that.
So I got really involved when Lonnie let me know a lot of the things I did not understand was the post-Fukushima environment. And in doing that, just following things, one of the things I think really super affects Eugene and trying to figure out how we can get our community to stand up and do something, I found that the thing that they announced on the news kind of flippantly about shipping that stuff, highly radioactive waste, out of Hanford all the way down the highway to New Mexico. So obviously, logic says that it's going to go through Eugene. And they've already stated it would take years worth of doing that to move what they would want to move. So I had this thought that maybe somehow that could be part of the key to how Eugenians feel like it's up to them to try to help make a difference. Like, I feel like this is this great progressive town, and somehow, like Kevin said, we can be some kind of catalyst to get some movement on this thing, because it's pretty deep and you start investigating it and it just gets deeper and deeper, and all of a sudden you're pretty darn overwhelmed. And I assume that's why people don't seem to stand up. Like, I just had a march that all the 20, 25 people went on yesterday, you know, and I'm thinking, wow, this is like Fukushima's anniversary and all this stuff in the papers and the news about Hanford, but we don't really have any energy going on. So I guess my question is, since you've been involved with this for a long time, is, you know, how do we create the campaign that gets people out there?
This is the key, and I learned this on my own, and this is why I took it on. These cameras are the key. Social media is the great equalizer. You know how many people are going to watch this? We have our handful group here today. You know how many people will see this today?
A lot.
Thousands and thousands. I have a network that has been built, Sweet Are the Uses of Adversity. Jan, Miss Milky the Clown, myself, Christina, Nuked Radio, we have a group all over the world. Learn to use, get a YouTube channel, Eugene Occupy, get a YouTube channel. And when you have a protest, I don't care if there's four people in that protest, people will see it in every nook and cranny corner of the world, and you will move minds, and it will slowly grow. People will be sitting across the street in your neighborhood or a block away and say, you know, because people don't watch the news anymore, rightfully so. They don't read newspapers, and rightfully so. But they're like, oh, did you see this YouTube video? That's so-and-so, my friend. She lives right down the block. Wow, did you know that? Oh, I didn't know that. And it was. This is going to take time. And this is a movement I equated to the, you know, Boo Moose 2.0. That movement took 30-something years. But we have social media. Use social media. Don't give up. I tell everybody, just, it's like rubbing sticks. You keep rubbing sticks, and I'll tell you when this is going to explode. At the end of Helen Kennicott's seminar for 2 days, Dr. Abrams was the last guy to speak from Stanford, the genius guru. He's a very, very old man. I'm sitting, I listened to every word of that entire symposium, and it was brilliant. At the end, the questions from the audience were going, what about the fish? What about the fish? What about, that's everybody's question. Everybody wants to know the true numbers. He said it just like this: my friends, aquariums, his anxiety, his whatever you want to call it, his marine biologist in Monterey, this is a friend of his, he says his caged tuna are undoubtedly full of cesium. He's, and that's all I need to hear. As soon as I hear that, I'm going, whoa. If he said it, it's gospel, I'm telling you. His, the man's integrity is beyond impeccable. He said it. That's all I needed to hear.
What, I didn't hear what he said.
Dr. Abrams spoke, was the last speaker at Helen Canicott's seminar.
Right, but I mean, just the gist of it.
The fish.
He said that tuna in his cages are full of cesium. Well, that's all I needed to hear. If the tuna have cesium in Monterey Bay in California, you don't get cesium 134 and cesium 137 in Santrum without plutonium. It all goes together. You know, when you have a nuclear leak out, these things are all together. If there's cesium in his tuna in Monterey, California, then that means there's cesium in tuna all up and down the Pacific Coast. And he said that. He said that.
What about the debris? I mean, do you think that debris, it's like the size of the state of Texas about to hit us next year?
June of 2013.
It's going to hit.
We're going to start.
So how radioactive do you think that is? Because all over the newspaper, every article I have read said, oh, it's not radioactive. Don't worry. In fact, they have organized children to pick up the debris.
Well, here's the big thing. We don't know. But let's use logic. You know, 700 days of this stuff going on, so we really don't know. And how are we going to know? I'll tell you how we're going to know. There's freelancers right here in this room today. There's one right there. They use Geiger counters to go out there. And we have a network that we've built. Us YouTube vloggers and us web, we have an incredible network of Geiger counters, freelancers. That's the only way we're going to know. They're going to have to be out there when the debris gets there with their Geiger counters, because we don't know. That's the only, how can we possibly know? No one knows. But logic tells us.
I have a great Geiger counter segue. The Marshall Islander friends in this town.
They're great.
Fasten pointed out that back where he's from in the islands of Melanesia in the South Pacific, nearby where the bomb tests happened that were made at Hanford. Marshall Islands. What'd I say? Okay. Anyways. His mom moved them out when he was 6 years old because she saw the number of children that were born as jellyfish babies. There's a word they've given them, a nickname, because there's so many mutant babies, embryos coming out, whatever they are called. And anyways, luckily he grew up here, but all his life he's been troubled because he looks good, but he doesn't know if he's a time-released thing that's going to be turning into the monster from the Deep Lagoon or whatever. And so I love him. He's so cool. And he pointed out that Bob Marley is beloved by the youth in the Marshall Islands. And I know that amongst the Hopi and the Navajo, Bob Marley and reggae. And so there's this music thing. So between the islanders here in this town and Nuke Info, which is the Columbia River Basin Watershed Stewardship, the Columbia River Basin Watershed Stewardship Alliance is formed starting last year on Fukushima Day. The Marshall Islanders came from Seattle and Olympia and joined with Thaston and me and Tribal and some local people at Hanford and had a ceremony in memory of the people of around the Fukushima area on that day. Geiger counters for every village, how about it? He said the most weird thing was where he grew up, all those villages in the Marshall Islands, they don't know if they're radiated. They don't know if there's nobody. Yeah, I know, but they don't have Geiger counters in every household. Don't you think each one of us should have one? So for $70, you could get a kit. So what we're going to do is, I have a friend in this town who is an electrical engineer. He's now turned into a publisher of International Children's Magazine. But him and I went to college in Vermont about 30 years ago, and he said he'll teach Thaston, who is into technology, he'll teach him how to do the soldering, and any other people we begin as being the first teachers. Then we're going to do a reggae music tour, and we're going to come to these towns, and the money that we get, every $70, will go towards a Geiger counter for that town. And we will have a lesson at the time of the tour for those that want to learn it in that town, from those that we bring as teachers, of how you solder together a Geiger counter for $70. They can just keep making $70 instead of partying for 4 nights.
Let me say one quick thing about the Marshall Islanders. A lot of people don't realize, you want to talk about the Bikini Islands down there, when they let off the big monster down there. And people know how the bikini's named. They thought it was sexy. That's how the bikini got its name, from Bikini Atoll. They're still inhabitable to this day, and they don't even go back. They go back and visit the cemeteries, and it is extremely commentated. This is what people don't realize about nuclear fallout. You don't go back. I mean, the half-life is plutonium is 24,000. That's half-life. I mean, if anybody doesn't know what half-life means, I mean, half. So, pretty well forever. And you're right, it causes mutation. If you want to see the book that was introduced at Helen Kennicott's, I suppose she had both the writers at her symposium, and he has pictures in Chernobyl. There was a little girl from Chernobyl in the hospital with me. She was 26 years old in our hospital. There's a video that I did in Symphony with Pussy Riot, with my Pussy Riot's protest. They're protesting the hijacking of Christianity in Russia, just like we should be here. Like on masquerading, marauding murderers calling themselves Christians. They're not Christians. So we all coincided on April 24th and did these videos all over. I did mine with my central line hanging out at my chest. And she was going to do it with us. You know, that's how Femen protests. They go bare-chested over there. And they go into Chernobyl, whatever, they get a lot of attention. She was going to do it with her central line hanging out. She passed away 2 days before we could do it. So there's still massive, massive mutation, babies being born all over Russia. I think the key thing is the average lifespan in Russia pre-Fukushima and post-Fukushima. There's plenty of data out there to support this. At her Helen's symposium, they said, he said, the old man, writer said, it went from 72 years old to 52 years old. Wow. That doesn't tell the tale in all of Russia. Wow. So, you know, and that's their data. It's very well researched data, you know. It's all hiding in plain sight.